Hi, my name's Cam McWilliams and I'm the Business Reform Leader at Chartered Accountants Australia and New Zealand. And today I'm joined by Kylie Porter, Executive Director from the Global Compact Network Australia. Welcome, Kylie.
Thanks, Karen.
So we're talking about our non-financial risks. So from a business perspective, have you seen a shift in thinking when it comes to non-financial risks in the last couple of years?
Yeah, absolutely. There's definitely been a growing understanding and I think also acceptance that economic numbers, the financial value of an organisation, its ability to generate significant return for shareholders are really not the sole drivers of growth. So what we've really seen is that companies acknowledge a lot more now than what they did probably even 5 or 10 years ago, that the main risks to their business are non-financial. And in fact, most of the changes to the reporting that we've seen over the years has been driven by non-financial risks. So this includes things like climate change, abuses of human rights, geopolitical risks, disease, technological changes. You know, all of these things have had huge impacts on a business's bottom line over the last couple of years. And the awareness and understanding of these risks from a non-financial perspective has definitely risen up the ranks of discussion points in boards, among boardrooms, I should say, in the last few years. And I think what we've really seen in terms of how companies are reporting and how they're acknowledging this is firstly through the UN Sustainable Development Goals. So when these were agreed by all 193 member states of the UN, it really provided businesses with a lighthouse from which to assess the environmental and social risks and opportunities associated with their business. And it gives a really good platform to understand what a lot of those environmental and social risks and opportunities are. We've also seen significant increases in companies reporting against the Task Force for Climate-Related Financial Disclosures, or TCFD, which is another initiative based on non-financial risks that's also highlighted the need for companies to consider the transition of physical risks of, consider the transition and also the physical risks of climate change in their business. And I think what's even happened more recently and is propelling the whole non-financial risks even further are things like Modern Slavery Act. So there's now a Modern Slavery Act in Australia, there's a Modern Slavery Act in the UK, and California and in the US and France also have their own initiatives in this space. And that's really also increased the need for companies to think about these non-financial risks and how they're going to impact on the way in which the business is run. So there's this growing, I guess, combination of mandatory versus voluntary reporting. And a lot of these are centered on non-financial risks, which I think over time will just continue to increase, not only in their complexity, but also in the maturity of those reports, of those reporting frameworks.
Thanks, Kylie. And how should businesses be looking at non-financial risks?
So businesses really need to look at non-financial risks as interconnected with their whole business. So for example, we know that climate change presents both a financial and non-financial risk to business, right? There are non-financial risks to the environment in terms of extreme weather events, biodiversity loss, an increase in natural disasters, an increase in societal-based issues, so things like what we're witnessing at the moment with the pandemic, so increases in zoonotic-based diseases, and also climate change can lead to human displacement. So we know that all of these events have a large financial impact, but they also have a very large non-financial impact. And understanding how those non-financial impacts interplay with a business is really how businesses should be looking at it. And that goes for a whole range of other risks, things like food crises, adverse developments in artificial intelligence, challenges in supply chain, transparency, and even what we talked about before with the impacts of modern slavery. So earlier this year, the GCNA, or the Global Compact Network Australia, released a report called the Pressures Report. And in that report, we really talked to a lot of the non-financial risks that could be facing business this year and beyond, and really what they need to recognise as part of those non-financial risks and how they are going to be integrated intrinsically into a business's overall strategy. So how a company decides to manage these risks will do one of two things. It will either build resilience for the company in that they're addressing the risk holistically, they understand that it has an impact on their strategy, on their operations, on how they do marketing and how they communicate, or over time it will cause the company to falter. So I think a good example is, you know, in our report, we didn't predict a global pandemic. I don't think anyone would have when we released that report at the start of the year. But the report recognised the very real risk of a non-financial, I should say, imposed by opaque supply chains. And the companies that we've seen over the course of the pandemic that acknowledged early and acted on the social risks inherent in supply chains, such as modern slavery, not providing decent work, or, you know, to a greater extent, the risk of child labour and the risk of human trafficking, those are the businesses that built mechanisms into their supply chain management process that has made them more resilient to crises or shocks. And so these companies have strategically responded to the risks, right? They've built better relationships with suppliers. They've understood how workers within a factory are being supported by the owners of the factory. They've put mechanisms in place to help ensure that their own staff and the health and safety of workers within their supply chain are actually protected. And from a reporting perspective, these are the companies that I believe we're going to see a lot more robust modern slavery statement reporting from. These are the companies where their shareholders and their key stakeholders are going to have a much better sense of the company's ability to understand the non-financial risks and how the business has protected themselves from those potential shocks. So I think overall, you know, non-financial risks aren't always going to be as obvious as a global pandemic, right? They're not necessarily all going to be events that immediately destabilize a business. But non-financial risks absolutely have the ability to destabilize business if we don't understand them, act on them, build resilience in our response. And I think, you know, if businesses don't start talking about risks from a non-financial and a financial sense, they're not actually going to understand how the risks interplay. You know, they need to be aware that there's also a growing expectation from the likes of shareholders, from institutional investors, from asset managers, around how they're going to manage these risks and how they're going to ensure that the business is sustainable for the long term. So, look, I'm probably rambling a bit, but overall I think what businesses need to do is understand non-financial risks and the ones that are more likely to impact their business, build a plan to respond to those as part of their overall strategic plan and vision, and ensure that the business, that all layers of the business understand this so that they can build enough resilience to survive in today's environment.
Thanks, Kylie. And I think the point you made around those sort of resilient businesses is incredibly important at this time.
Yeah.
I was also going to ask you, what is the role and responsibility for management and accountants when it comes to considering non-financial risks? Now, you've sort of just covered that, but if you've got anything else to add, feel free.
Yeah, I think, you know, we've obviously talked about the role, the intersection of different layers of management. I guess, you know, from a Chartered Accountants Australia and New Zealand perspective, a lot of your, I would assume that a fair few of your stakeholders are in that chief financial officer, financial professionals area within an organisation. And I think it's important to recognise that the CFO or equivalent is actually a core component to developing the strategy to respond to those risks. So the CFO's team and the finance professionals that work within that team are really integral to translating those non-financial risks into the operating impacts of a business, understanding what the financial impacts could be of those non-financial risks, but also what the impact is on the broader operating environment. And I think one of the big things about non-financial risks is that when a business starts to understand them, they're also able to break down silos between different divisions within a business. So the finance team can work more productively with the risk teams where they find how to derive value from the risks and shape opportunities, which ultimately can actually help to completely reshape aspects of the business. They can work together to build a business based on the risk tolerance level and the materiality of the risks facing the business. But they also play a really important role in ensuring that management and leadership comes along for the ride, that they understand that these big non-financial risks shouldn't be approached in a way that is just reactionary. But it's a process. It's a process by which an organisation can learn how what is going to face them in the future, build resilience again, but also harness opportunities. And I think that's a really important part in non-financial risks, is not just viewing them as a negative on the business, but actually viewing them from the perspective that they provide an opportunity to really harness opportunities and think about business as unusual. Think about different ways of running business, different ways of, I guess, the risk-reward trade-off, for want of a better term, like thinking about, well, what is it that we can do now to protect us from a risk that might not eventuate for 10 or 15 years, but it will set us up to be a much stronger business in the long run.
Thank you, Kylie. That was great. Thanks for joining us today.
Thanks, Karen.